Good evening. Thanks for joining us on India Business Hour. I'm Shireen Bhan. The headlines we're tracking at this hour. Inflation worries dominate the last monetary policy meeting. The minutes show governor and the RBI members sound more hawkish on inflation than the external members. Jayant Varma says MPC's stance of withdrawal of accommodation is confusing. Aggressive selling drags the Sensex and the Nifty a percent lower. A higher dollar, rising crude prices and surging bond yields weigh on sentiment today. Key indices close higher for the fifth week, though. The rupee weakens as the dollar rallies globally to a one-month high. Foreign money returns to Indian equities with a bang. The open market sees over $4 billion worth of deal activity in the last 1 month. Block deals, QIPs and preferential issues become a popular investment option. The CBI files a charge sheet against Delhi's Deputy Chief Minister Manish Sisodia and 14 others over alleged irregularities with the state's excise policy. The agency raids the residence of the Deputy Chief Minister and 20 other locations. Sisodia welcomes the CBI, adding, nothing will come out of the case.
I think the trend towards online is just, it's explosive and it's not going to change.
Adobe's global CEO Shantanu Narayan says the digital boom is here to stay. He's betting big on India and is also upbeat about the opportunities presented by the metaverse. The government cuts the windfall gains tax on domestic crude oil but hikes the tax imposed on the export of diesel. Also imposes a tax of 2 rupees per litre on aviation turbine fuel. The government is set to kickstart the process to monetize Hotel Ashok in Delhi. Roadshows to begin from the 22nd of August and options given by prospective bidders will be taken to the Union Cabinet for approval. Apple reveals security flaws that could allow hackers to take complete control of its devices like the iPhone, the iPad and Macs. Releases software updates to fix the issue but does not disclose how many users may have been affected. Well, let's start the action on the Lal Street. The market snapping its eight-day gaining streak, with financials and real estate stocks leading the loss today. All sectoral indices closing in the red. But if you take a look at the weekly performance, the Sensex and the Nifty have managed to post marginal gains for the week, making it the fifth consecutive week of gains for the Indian equity markets. And across in the currency market, the rupee weakened as the US dollar rallied globally to a one-month high. The currency opened lower at 79.70 to the dollar and closed at the session the same level. Foreign money is returning to India Inc. and it's doing it in style. Foreign funds have picked up equity in various companies worth $4 billion over the last 1 month itself. But there's a difference this time. Instead of boardroom deals, foreign funds are choosing the open market route. Prashant Nair is standing by with the CNBC TV 18 analysis.
So I counted the numbers. It adds up to $4 billion worth of deals that we've seen over the last 1 month. So this is actually not even full 30, 31 days, working days. It'd be less than that. So $4 billion, I mean, it's a large figure. So, maybe I've missed out many, but this has all the prominent large ones, right? Most of these are block trades where there is one entity which is selling and, I mean, maybe one on the other side or many entities buying. Look at Zomato. That was right at the beginning of August, 3,100 crores worth of block, which changed hands. Where is the Zomato share price from the time that the deal happened? The deal was struck at 50 rupees. If you take the current market price, Zomato share price is about 29% higher from that price. So not only did a very large block trade happen, the price has moved up since. You look at HDFC AMC, another block trade, 12.6% higher, the share price. It was a 2,300 crore block trade. AU Bank was a QIP worth 2,000 crores. Again, we are higher. Loda, which is Macrotech, 1,000 crore block trade, 10% is the price change since then. Crompton Consumer was a pretty large block trade as well. That's 800 crores. Yes Bank is a preferential issue, but I've included that purposely because, I mean, for an entity like Yes Bank to raise 8,000 crores was maybe 2 months back, 3 months back, unthinkable, right? But it's done that, and marquee investors have come in. Sona Comstar, block trade of 4,900 crores. Max Healthcare, of course, the most recent, 9,200 crores, the larger and the more recent one. And CAMS, of course, that we saw on Friday, 459 crores or so. So just what are some of the takeaways, at least for me, from what all this data? Large blocks, QIPs, preferential issues are a frequent occurrence now. So in a way, the market, which was closed for these kind of transactions, is open once again. Average stock price gains of all those 9 deals that I mentioned, from the strike price, the deal price to the CMP, is about 11%, which is not bad. Just a few sort of specific names to give you a flavor of what's going on. GIC, Government of Singapore, has been a big buyer in deals. So, you know, I could look at specific deals like Max Healthcare, Sona, Comstar, etc., where they've come in heavily. Capital International, which cumulatively in India owns about $50 billion worth of stocks. They are big buyers. They bought clean 10% of Max Healthcare in one shot, right? So another, it's basically a vote of confidence, nothing else. As I said, Yes Bank, right? Unthinkable 3 months back, but they've got commitment from a player like Carlyle, big number. And of course, other old investors like Fidelity, GQG Partners, etc., they've been buyers as well. This is a number I put out earlier this week on Twitter, but I think it's a relevant one, which many are asking. FIIs, and by the way, all this deal activity has happened as FIIs have bought $3.5 billion, right? This is July till date, $3.5 billion. And all this activity, the market opens up for companies to raise money, block trades are happening. But that is a fraction. That's a fraction of what they sold between October 2021 and June 2029. It's a tantalizing thought. They sold 33, they've only bought back about 10, little over 10% of what they sold. I mean, what happens if they're buyers in greater force, greater numbers? Where could the market be? And I think that's a question which many out there are asking.
Prashant, many thanks for joining us. Big numbers there coming in on Deal Street. Now, inflation worries dominated the last monetary policy meeting. According to the minutes of the meeting, RBI governor and RBI members sound more hawkish on inflation than the external members of the MPC. One external member, Jayant Varma, says the MPC's stance of withdrawal of accommodation is confusing. Lata is here with more on the minutes of the meeting and what it could mean as far as future policy trajectories are concerned. Lata.
Well, one key takeaway clearly is that the Reserve Bank's members in the MPC sound a little more concerned about inflation than the external members. The governor in particular clearly saying that now once they move within the 2 to 6% band, they should start moving towards 4. So that clearly sounds they are more concerned about inflation and its second round impact on inflation expectation. Among the external members, Dr. Varma's dissent to the removal of accommodation stance seems to be more a dovish dissent, but he clarified that he dissented more because the stance sounded confusing to him. In fact, he seems to be rooting for more clarity by asking the members to vote on a dot chart like the FOMC, which other members were not agreeable. A third takeaway is that Ashima Goyal seems way more confident about the growth part, saying that even exports may not be hurt so much by recession. However, Dr. Shashanka Bide, the main takeaway seems to be that he has some concerns on growth, that exports could be affected by recession, and some concerns on inflation because a lower kharif can continue to impact inflation. The net-net from the minutes, one can only say that we are not any the wiser that we were after the August 8th policy statement. It does look like one more hike in October is definitely on the cards because the Reserve Bank will have to write a letter to Parliament explaining why it failed in achieving a sub 6% CPI for 3 quarters in a row. So a hike definitely looks on the cards in October, but that is exactly what we thought at the end of the August 8th policy statement itself. The minutes are not going to change the market's mind on anything. They will continue to expect a few rate hikes, definitely one in October. But nobody expects that, the Reserve Bank will go on hiking all the way till 6.5% or 7%. So it really is a reiteration of the status quo after the August 8th policy.
Monetary policy, we know, acts with lags. And there is nothing that we can do today that would avoid a failure if that is really around the corner. But we have to be focused on what is the likely situation 3 quarters ahead, 4 quarters ahead. We cannot be reacting in a knee-jerk fashion to this.
In the past, the spikes in food inflation have come from vegetables, particularly, I think. So I guess there are always those uncertainties attached to food inflation. But I think clearly, for food inflation, the cereals are going to be important going forward. So both in the case of rice and wheat. So I guess there is uncertainty attached to this, but I think these are the concerns.
And if you see the RBI inflation projections, they really rose because they factored in higher oil prices and higher fuel inflation in general. So if oil prices come in, then the inflation in the next few months is going to be much below RBI projections. Obviously, you will not need as much of a hike or, you know, as we've been having, or we'll have to see.
Well, that's the reaction to the MPC's minutes. Now, crude oil prices remain lower despite an expected drawdown in U.S. crude stocks. The drop in U.S. inventories brushed off worries about a global economic slowdown, denting oil demand. Some relief, though, for domestic crude refiners. The government has cut the windfall gains tax on domestic crude to 13,000 rupees a ton. However, export tax on diesel and aviation turbine fuel has been hiked by 2 rupees a litre. This is part of the fortnightly review. On to the cryptocurrency market, where all major coins are under pressure as global trading volume has dropped by 10%. Ethereum has seen a drop of nearly 20% ahead of a major upgrade to its protocol. The second largest crypto will move from a proof-of-work protocol that relies on miners to mine coins to a proof-of-stake setup that relies on coin owners to validate transactions and earn rewards for doing so. Here's the latest from the power sector. Yesterday, 13 states were barred from buying or selling power on exchanges after they failed to clear dues. Today, we understand 6 states, including Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, Jharkhand, Bihar, Chhattisgarh and Manipur, have cleared their dues and have been allowed to trade. States like Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh continue to remain barred from the power exchanges as they are yet to clear their dues. The Adani Group is likely to have received the market regulator's approval to launch an open offer worth $3.8 billion for Ambuja and ACC. Bloomberg reports Adani will offer 385 rupees for every share of Ambuja and 2,300 rupees for every share of ACC. The U.S. drug regulator has issued 6 observations to the Sun Pharma Mohali plant. CNBC TV 18 has accessed the observations. The FDA claims sampling and test procedures were not reported properly and the company has failed to review discrepancies. The Mahindra Group is exploring the acquisition of General Motors' Talegaon plant in Maharashtra. We learned from sources the talks between the two companies are at very early stages and no decision has been taken yet. This comes over a month after General Motors' deal to sell the plant to China's Great Wall Motor fell through. The Talegaon plant is also closer to Mahindra's Chakan facility. The CEO of PB FinTech, Yashish Dhaya, expects the company to turn a profit by the end of FY24. The promoter of Policy Bazaar says that they expect to turn positive in terms of adjusted EBITDA by the end of this financial year.
PAT positive, I can smell things which I do not have numbers for. My view is it will be sooner than most people expect. Now, the reason I say I can smell things is because the difference you're talking about is just the ESOP cost.
Correct.
By the end of this year, we would have accounted for about 55 to 60% of the ESOP charge that we are going to have over a 4-year period, over a 5-year period.
Okay.
So a bulk of the ESOP charges would be over.
Well, that's Policy Bazaar on the road to profitability. Shares of multiplex chains PVR and Inox Leisure under pressure. This after a non-profit group called Consumer Unity and Trust Society approached the Competition Commission against a proposed merger of the two companies. This non-profit alleges that the deal will have anti-competitive effects on the film exhibition industry. Remember, on the 27th of March, PVR and Inox Leisure announced a merger to create the largest multiplex chain in the country with a network of over 1,500 screens. The government is set to kickstart the process to monetize Hotel Ashok in Delhi. Roadshows to begin from the 22nd of August and options given by prospective bidders will be taken to the Union Cabinet for approval. The manufacturers of Dolo 650 have rubbished allegations that they distributed freebies worth 1,000 crore rupees to doctors to prescribe the tablet to patients. The company's executive vice president of marketing and communication, Jairaj Govindraju, told Money Control that the company's total turnover during COVID was only 350 crore rupees and it was impossible for the company to spend 1,000 crore rupees on freebies. He's also denied claims of giving any freebies to doctors for prescribing the drug. Remember, this matter is now in the Supreme Court. The big newsmaker this evening, Adobe CEO Shantanu Narayen, believes the explosive growth we're seeing in the digital economy is here to stay. Speaking exclusively to me, he made it clear that the genie cannot be put back in the bottle. Adobe has big plans for India. Narayen is also upbeat on the opportunities presented by the metaverse. This is an interesting number that I picked up from your earnings call for the last quarter, where you talk about the fact that consumers have spent $1 billion more online in May of this year compared to April. And year-to-date, shoppers have spent over $377 billion online. That's a 9% growth year-on-year. So you believe that despite the uncertainties, despite the inflationary pressures, this is likely to continue, this trend line?
There's no question. The genie is not going back in the bottle in terms of how people engage with customers. And what you're referring to, Shireen, is the third business that we have, which is the digital experience business, or the experience cloud. And we have this unprecedented view of what people are doing digitally, because our business strategy there is enabling businesses to power their businesses digitally. And so the Adobe Digital Index report is an ability for us to aggregate what's happening. And, you know, I think people were always looking at, is the growth accelerating?
Yeah.
But the reality is that more and more of this stuff is happening online. What they were buying changed. And, you know, we have really good insight into what's happening with inflation. And certainly, I think people moved a little bit more towards groceries as well as more, you know, things that they needed for their running of their houses. But I think the trend towards online is just, it's explosive, and it's not going to change. The metaverse, on the other hand, is actually very interesting. And it's interesting for the simple reason that the way I like to describe it is, more and more things that you did in the physical world, you're going to do in the virtual world. Whether it's experiencing travel, whether it's experiencing medical care, whether it's, you know, transacting business, whether it's doing online commerce. Now, that's being labeled the metaverse. Mm. And so the content creation and the interactivity that you have to do on the metaverse is an order of magnitude more difficult, because you now have to not only create the ability to have this immersive experience, but you have to have the ability to interact with, as they say abroad, the avatars or the avatars or whatever. And so Adobe has this unique role to play where we're telling all of these brands, this is how you start to dip your toe in the water. This is how you create a brand. And what's happening, unfortunately, right now in the metaverse is you have multiple worlds. And so, you know, these brands have to decide, which world am I betting on? Mm. But I think the whole content creation process is something that we can help them with. We have a white paper.
Well, that's Adobe's global CEO, Shantanu Narayan. Now, Narayan may have studied in what could arguably be one of the best schools in the world. He's an alumnus of Hyderabad Public School, founded in 1923. And this private school had produced not one, but three top tech CEOs who were pivotal figures in the global tech world. The CEO of Microsoft, Satya Nadella, and the former CEO of MasterCard, Ajay Banga, also studied in the same school with Adobe Shantanu Narayan. Another illustrious alumnus is Prem Vatsa, the founder of Fairfax. Narayan recounted his time in school when Prem Vatsa's father was the principal.
Tell you, the CEO of Microsoft, Satya Nadella, MasterCard, Ajay Banga, Adobe, Shantanu Narayan, and myself, we had one commonality. We all went to the same school, Hyderabad Public School, and in India, in Hyderabad. And my dad, who's long passed away now, but my dad was the principal of that school. He was vice principal, and he was a teacher, and he ended his career by being the principal of that school. So I have a bias to those CEOs.
Prem Vatsa's father was actually our principal.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I don't know. It was magical. It was a magical time.
Do you talk
time.
About this? Have you, you know, I'm sure you have you discussed what it could have been about that environment?
Well, I think, you know, there were two things for me in particular that stood out. The first was it wasn't just about academics. It was so much about academics and extracurricular activities. You know, I was the editor of the school magazine. I was the captain of the debate team. You had to play sports every evening, in which case you learned about team. And I think the second part was leadership. You know, we had the prefect system and stuff like that. So I think, you know, they were at the end of the day just trying to provide you with all of the tools that you needed. You know, but it's... I know people have said if there's a way to bottle that, right?
Yes.
That would be nice. But it was an amazing place.
Well, you can catch that entire conversation with Shantanu Narayen, the global CEO of Adobe, on the Global Dialogue tonight at 9:30 p.m. right here on CNBC TV 18. Time for us to head into a break, but up next, the CBI raids the residence of Delhi's Deputy Chief Minister Manish Sisodia and 20 other locations in connection with a probe into the alleged irregularities in the state's excise policy. That and more when we return. The big national story, the Central Bureau of Investigation has filed an FIR against Delhi's Deputy Chief Minister Manish Sisodia and 14 others in a case over alleged irregularities in the state's excise policy. The residence of Delhi Deputy Chief Minister Sisodia and 20 other locations were raided today. Sisodia has been named an accused number one. In his response, Sisodia said, and I quote, "Welcome the CBI," added that nothing will come out of this case. The Aam Aadmi Party and Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal have strongly condemned the raids. CBI also raided the former Commissioner of Excise and other former government officials.
पिछले सात साल में भी मनीष जी के ऊपर न जाने कितनी बार रेड हुई है, ये पहली रेड नहीं है, पहले भी कई बार रेड कर चुके, कई झूठे केस कर चुके मनीष जी के ऊपर, मेरे ऊपर कई बार रेड कर चुके, सतिंदर जैन पे, कैलाश गहलोत पे, हमारे कितने लोगों पे ये लोग रेड कर चुके, कुछ नहीं मिला, अभी भी कुछ नहीं मिलेगा।
केजरीवाल मॉडल को खत्म करने के लिए भाजपा ने हेल्थ मिनिस्टर को, हमारे स्वास्थ्य मंत्री सत्येंद्र जैन को जेल में बंद कर दिया, जो कई महीनों से जेल में बंद है, और मनीष सिसोदिया जी पर आज रेड कर उन्हें भी जेल में बंद करने की तैयारी है कि शिक्षा और स्वास्थ्य के इनके मॉडल को बर्बाद करो, इनके मंत्रियों को गिरफ्तार करो ताकि केजरीवाल मॉडल बर्बाद हो जाए, अरविंद केजरीवाल खत्म हो जाए। ये भारतीय जनता पार्टी की सोच है, प्रधानमंत्री जी की सोच है।
जैसी सीबीआई ने जांच को शुरू किया, उन्होंने लिकर पॉलिसी को खत्म कर दिया। तो अगर आपकी लिकर पॉलिसी ठीक थी तो आपने उसको क्यों चेंज किया? आप क्यों अपना पुरानी पॉलिसी के ऊपर में जा रहे हैं? और अगर आपकी पॉलिसी ठीक नहीं थी तो अगर आप उसमें दोषी हैं, या तो वो राजस्व का नुकसान हुआ तो भी दोषी हैं, या आपने लिकर माफियाओं से पैसे लिए तो भी दोषी हैं, तो सारी बातें सामने आ जाएंगी।
So that is the latest in the big national story, the Deputy Chief Minister of Delhi, Manish Sisodia, being raided by the CBI. On Startup Corner today, we take stock of all the big deals that have taken place. Shruti is here with the Startup Snapshot this evening. Shruti.
Here's all the action from startup deal space this week. According to Venture Intelligence, the Indian startup ecosystem witnessed 24 deals valued at $173 million this week. For 2022, the startup space saw 780 deals valued at $19.27 billion. Speaking of some notable deals, logistics aggregator ShipRocket raised $32 million from Temasek, Lightrock India, Bertelsmann India Investments, among others. With this fundraise, the company turned unicorn and is currently valued at $1.3 billion. Logistics tech startup HyperTrack raised $25 million from Westbridge Capital and Nexus Venture Partners. Fintech app Jar raised $22.6 million from Tiger Global, Arkham Ventures, Eximius Ventures, Rocketship VC, among others. Neo banking platform Fi raised $17 million from Temasek and QCM Holdings. And finally, access provider to create a data Philo raised $15 million from RTP Global, Nexus Venture Partners, Better Capital and iSeed. With that, it's back to you.
All right, Shruti, many thanks for joining us. That's a Startup Snapshot this Friday evening. And with that, it is time for us to wrap up this edition of India Business Hour. Have a great weekend. We'll see you Monday.